this year, the Queen is celebrating her Diamond Jubilee, and millions of us have joined the party. This week, she's been in the Midlands, and yet again, the crowds have turned out in force.
But what is it that inspires such devotion? Why does the Queen hold such a special place in so many people's hearts?
To find out, I'm going to be touring my home turf, the West Midlands, visiting the places she's been.
Oh, there's me.
Yes, she is.
And meeting the people whose lives she's touched.
Quite honestly, it was one of the best days of your lives, in actual fact.
I remembered thinking, by the time I come back down this road later, I'm going to meet the Queen.
And I'll be having my own brush with royalty. I'll be finding out what this enduring monarch means to you and me, the people of the West Midlands.
Now, when it comes to initial research, this is a pretty good place to start. The archives of the BBC in Birmingham.
There are local newsreels here dating back as far as the 1970s. The Queen appears on them time and time again, making dozens of visits to the region.
There have been some huge changes in the West Midlands during my lifetime, and the Queen has witnessed them all. She seems to like to pop in every now and again, check up on us, see that we're doing all right.
She's shared in our Midlands story, the highs and sometimes the lows. And it's the people and places from these films which I'm going to be visiting. Our story begins 60 years ago, so what better way to get around on my road trip than this?
If ever a car epitomised the new Elizabethan age, it was a Morris Minor. It first rolled off the Birmingham production lines in the late 40s, and by the time of the Queen's coronation in 1953, it was the car to be seen in.
The coronation was a time of celebration, but it might not have felt like there was much else to be cheerful about in 50s Britain.
That's your ration for the week. There's no more.
That's the same.
That's the lot.
Well, what am I supposed to do with that?
What you like.
They were lean times, and there was still plenty of work to do to rebuild our bomb-scarred cities.
The Midlands suffered particularly badly at the hands of the Luftwaffe, and it was a gradual rebuilding that brought the Queen, in the early years of her reign, here to Coventry.
An infamous German bombing raid in 1940 had devastated Coventry. Large parts of the city had been reduced to rubble, including its Gothic cathedral.
The ruins of the cathedral have been left standing as a permanent and painful reminder of the suffering that Coventry endured. And they say so much about the city itself, which emerged from the war battered and bruised, but refusing to be beaten.
When the Queen came here in 1956, it was to mark the start of a fresh chapter, as work began on a new cathedral, right next door to the old.
I declare this stone well and truly laid.
6 years later, she was back for its consecration, and local amateur filmmaker David Arnold was there.
It was a very big occasion, mm-hmm. Very big occasion. A new cathedral, mm-hmm. And I just wanted to come and get a record of it.
Well, we've got the record here.
Oh.
It's been transposed onto one of these very, very modern things. So we've got all of these wonderful people. This goes on for ages. There were so many people there, weren't there?
Yes.
On and on and on they go. You're waiting for the Queen, desperate. And then, all of a sudden, she just pops up like that. So what happened there?
It was really quite difficult. Bear in mind that this camera is a wind-up camera.
Right.
It's got no battery, and the films only lasted 4 minutes.
Right.
I can't remember specifically what happened there, but I was probably having to wind it up.
Yeah, I bet you were sweating on that a little bit, weren't you?
This always seems to happen at the most crucial points.
Yeah.
I'm very glad that I got her at all. She was young, very attractive, bright yellow, and she always stands out.
How important do you think it was that the Queen came to this event?
Apart from London, I think Coventry had the worst time in the war, and I think the Queen was here to represent the country, and this was an opportunity of saying, we're up, we're going, we're in business. So I think it was very important.
The modern new cathedral was Coventry looking to the future, and in this, the city wasn't alone. Across the Midlands, the gloom of the 1950s was lifting, giving way to a new optimism. In Birmingham, reconstruction was advancing at a furious pace as the city launched itself into a new era.
There were grand infrastructure projects, new road and rail networks, and buildings like the Rotunda changing the Birmingham skyline.
As for the Queen, she shared in the adventure. She was here to open the Bullring, Europe's largest shopping centre. So too, the new Inner Ring Road, named the Queensway after her. And then, the NEC.
The opening of this centre is the beginning of a new enterprise for the future prosperity of our country.
But what did she really make of Brum? As a prominent city councillor, Freda Cox met her many times, including as Lord Mayor.
She always enjoyed coming to Birmingham. The only thing she didn't like, the tall blocks of flats. One of the time when she went round, she said, don't forget, you're not only building buildings for the city, you're building them for people. And that's what's so important.
Tower blocks aside, the Queen was impressed by the city's transformation. But she was no stranger to change herself.
For centuries, a royal visit meant the monarch safely cocooned inside a royal coach or car, away from the baying mob. But this Queen had other ideas.
The walkabout, often unplanned and unscripted, but always to the delight of the crowds, and to her ardent fans, like Henley James.
Once you were within reach and you could stretch your hand to her, she would shake that hand. Unfortunately, I was too far about, so I didn't get a shake on because I don't think I'd wash my hands for the rest of my life. This is the reason why everybody talks about her, because she's always in touch with people.
But along with the good times, there's also been the bad.
I was on patrol with another officer and we got the call to search the Rotunda for a bomb. And we went in with other officers, just about to get in the lift, and it went off underneath us.
In November 1974, the IRA bombed two pubs in Birmingham, killing 21 people and injuring many more. The emergency services faced horrendous scenes, and we're uniting some of those involved for the first time. Among them, policewoman Margaret Adams and fireman Dave Pithy.
So, those images there must bring back an awful lot of memories. Dave, what's your abiding memory of that night?
Well, chaos, basically. And the thing that struck me more than anything, and I made the point at the time, was the number of young men who'd been in the tavern, not rushing out, but helping everybody else to come out. And, you know, it was, if you like, a community spirit.
Terry Curley was in charge of a taxi firm which helped to ferry the wounded to the hospital.
It was a shocking night. It was a credit to all concerned how well it was dealt with.
And recognition for their actions went far beyond the city. When the Queen made an official visit a few months later, meeting them was her top priority.
Oh, there's me.
There she is. There she is.
She seemed quite almost shy when she talked.
It certainly made the drivers concerned feel proud, and the whole taxi trade. It's not very often they get good publicity.
Did you feel, Margaret, that helped to lift the mood of the city?
Oh, it did. It did, because it was an awful time afterwards, really, particularly for Irish people living in Birmingham, I think. And it was a wonderful time when she came. Everybody was excited about it.
It did lift everybody's spirits. And quite honestly, it was just, you know, one of the best days of your lives, in actual fact.
The 1970s was a turbulent decade in other ways too, blighted by rising unemployment and growing political and social tensions. Punk arrived, and by the time of the Silver Jubilee in 1977, the Sex Pistols' anti-monarchy single, God Save the Queen, was striking a chord with plenty of discontented youths. I was contented, but far from a royalist.
Now, I'd like to say that my memories of the 1977 Jubilee are all of bunting and street parties and commemorative mugs, but the truth is, I was a 15-year-old boy. My memories are of pop music, football, and a girl called Juliet.
But it turned out that I was in the minority. Hard times didn't seem to have dented the public's patriotic spirit, and the Jubilee was celebrated with gusto.
We were in a celebratory mood, because this was something that you anticipated but never knew you would have seen in your lifetime. And when it happened, it was marvelous.
When the Queen made a whirlwind tour of the Midlands, thousands lined the streets. And for one Rolls-Royce mechanic in Wolverhampton, the day would take an unexpected twist.
The service manager of the garage I worked for came in quite a panic, saying, "Quick, Fred, get your tools, the Queen's broken down in Warsaw." And I was eating my chips, and I jumped up, sort of saying, panicking, "Oh, great, you know, off we go." And then I thought, hang on. I said, "No, it's a wind-up."
But it was no joke, and it was down to Fred to get the Royal Rolls back on the road.
That was the biggest bugbear in the back of your mind, thinking if you get there and you can't do anything with it, you're going to look a right blank, you know. And funnily enough, when we've determined the problem and actually got the car to run, because the fuse had blown on the fuel pumps, it started up, and there was a roar and a cheer and a clap. I thought, great. And then he stopped again. So I thought, yeah, okay.
It wasn't long, though, before Fred had it fixed, and he was soon rewarded with a letter from the palace.
"Your assistance resulted in the tour going along without delay, and we are all most grateful for the help given by you and other members of your staff. I shall treasure it. It'll always be with me." It's just one of those never-to-be-repeated opportunities, you know. And it could have been anyone in the garage that went that day, but I was the only one that didn't go to lunch. So I was picked to go.
She'd always vowed to be a servant of the people, and the Silver Jubilee celebration suggested that the Queen's common touch was working. And as head of the Anglican Church too, she was finding ways to get closer to her subjects. Every Easter, she honours people who've served their communities at the Royal Maundy Service. It used to always be held in London, but not anymore.
The Queen decided that it would actually make more sense for the service to visit different cathedrals in the country rather than always taking place in London. This would mean two things. One, the recipients would be able to be chosen from a different part of the country, so other people would come to benefit from this honour. And secondly, more people from other parts of the country would then be able to see the service and come as members of the congregation.
The Royal Maundy Service was first held in the West Midlands in Tewkesbury in 1971, before Hereford 5 years later, and in the 80s, Worcester, Lichfield and Birmingham all had the honour. But for Paul Leddington Wright, one year in particular stands out. It's his job to organise the event, a post previously held by his father, Peter. And in the 90s, the service came to home soil.
In 1995, I was the organist and director of music at Coventry Cathedral. And that year happened to be my father's last year as secretary. And the Queen always decides where the service goes. It is her service. And she's trying to visit all the cathedrals in the country with this service, and she's only got four more to go. But in 1995, because it was my father's last year, and also I was the organist at the cathedral, the Queen did agree that it would visit Coventry in that year, which was a rather nice touch, if you like.
Northeast Birmingham's very own community radio station, it's 107.5. Switch radios.
By then, much had changed in the Midlands since the Queen's early visits. Some of the dreams of the post-war years had turned sour, like at Birmingham's Castle Vale estate. When she visited in 1998, it was to back a new regeneration scheme. At this community radio station, they're still talking about it.
It was a fantastic occasion. It was one that lifted local spirits because Castle Vale had come through a very difficult period, but they were spending lots of money at the time through this big regeneration of the area. It was a pretty amazing reaction locally.
And did you manage to get her to come into the studio or do anything for you? Or?
Last night she couldn't come to the studio, what we did, Prince's Trust had got Buckingham Palace to agree that the Queen would record a message for Vale FM that we would have exclusive rights to broadcast. Which is pretty unprecedented, probably to this day.
So I need to hear the message now, obviously.
Of course. Well, here goes. This is what she said.
Today, I have been able to see how in Castle Vale, the Prince's Trust has helped encourage the talents and achievements of young people through community and business projects, including this local radio station run by them. I wish all those involved in the work of the Prince's Trust in Castle Vale continuing success.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Oh, is that a little laugh?
The royal giggle, no less.
You've got a royal giggle?
Yeah, I rather cheekily said that's a take to the Queen, and she laughed at that.
That is wonderful. You could only have been better if you'd got her to introduce the travel or the weather or something like that.
Yes, and she was the most glamorous person we'd ever had to produce a promo. We did try Gordon Cairns, ex-Villa star, but he turned us down.
And
yeah.
You got the Queen instead.
We got the Queen instead.
But then things got even more surreal, thanks to one of the station's young staff members, Andrew Hendricks, also known as DJ Sweet Vibes.
He'd had ER2 sculpted into the back of his head, and he was desperately trying to get the Queen and Prince Philip's attention for them to notice him. And when they did, Prince Philip spun Andrew round so that the Queen could see the back of Andrew's head. At that point, the press moved in, the newspaper coverage in the Times, the Mirror, obviously in the locals as well. For a radio station like us that was just trying to find its way, it's fantastic profile.
The radio station wasn't her only appointment that day. There was also the opening of Birmingham's brand new children's hospital, named after Princess Diana, who'd been killed in a car crash the year before. Nick Plotneck remembers the occasion well.
My son Robert was quite ill at the time, and he had a problem with one of his valves, heart valves. The Queen came to open the hospital, and everyone was looking forward to it. And after sort of interminable wait, suddenly there she was. She appeared with Prince Philip in intensive care. My first impression was how friendly she was. And it's not until you meet her you realise that she's really not very tall, but a great presence and a great personality.
Sadly, Robert didn't survive his illness, but a photograph of his meeting with the Queen remained at his bedside until he died.
Sadly, he'd had a lot of operations during his life, and it was just too much for him, and he died in 2003. We're all here for as long as we're here, and obviously one of the highlights for him and for me was, and for the rest of the family, was to meet the Queen. It was a great honour and a privilege.
An emotional encounter, no doubt. And as I head to Staffordshire, it's to find out about another one, this time linked with the Queen's role as head of the armed forces, which have recently become increasingly involved in conflicts around the world. Those who've lost their lives in these wars are honoured here at the Armed Forces Memorial.
Until 2007, there was no dedicated memorial to those that had given their lives in service of their country since the Second World War. This was very upsetting for many of the families. So when this memorial was finally completed after a long campaign, it was quite a milestone. One of those delighted by its creation is Maureen Norton, whose brother Terence Griffin was killed by an IRA bomb. Maureen, I know that this place is very important to you, and I wondered if you could just tell us something about what happened to your brother.
He lost his life on the M62 coach bomb on the 4th of February 1974. After spending his last weekend at home with us, his family brought his friend home, and then on the Sunday evening he caught coach from Manchester to Catterick, and a bomb had been placed on the coach, and sadly 12 people lost their lives, two of them little boys.
Where is he?
Terence's name is the third one down from the top.
Got you.
His name's just below his friend's name. He brought his friend home with him that last weekend.
You'd have thought when they stepped onto that coach that we'd end up here looking at his name.
Yes, I know. And but for there being a rail strike that day, he wouldn't have been on that coach. It's tragic, really.
5 years ago, the Queen was here to witness the Armed Forces Memorial's official dedication, and Maureen got to meet her.
It was a really lovely experience, and she was really, really came over very warmly. You know, I felt as though she had empathy for what me and my family had gone through. It might have been because she'd lost Lord Mountbatten.
The Queen's cousin had also been killed by the IRA a few years after Maureen's brother, and her presence at the dedication ceremony struck a chord with the public.
Her presence made the whole event, the memorial, nationally credible and important, and I think that cannot be underestimated. Up till then, it had been open on a fairly low-key basis and was attracting about 60,000 visitors a year. Instantly, the visiting numbers went up to over 300,000.
There are many sides to the Queen's role in public life, from head of the church and the armed forces to patron of the arts. And that's what's brought me here, to the picturesque Warwickshire town of Stratford-upon-Avon, otherwise known as the home of Shakespeare. And you can't really visit Stratford without coming here, the Royal Shakespeare Theatre, which has recently undergone a multi-million pound revamp, a new Elizabethan makeover for our old Elizabethan playwright. The shiny new auditorium has been designed to bring audiences closer than ever to the action. When its royal patron officially opened it last year, it was a big day for all the staff. But behind the scenes, there was one guy who I reckon had the toughest job of all. Head chef Nick Fennell is used to cooking for the great and good, but finding out the Queen was coming for lunch was enough to rattle even him.
Utter horror to start with, and then a real sense of pride and, privilege. You knew that you were doing something very important and it had to be right. So, we've got the lemon sole wrapped with salmon mousse and spinach.
Food fit for the Queen has got to be pretty special. But the good bit is that Nick's agreed to make it again, for me. Dorset sole with salmon mousse, with spring cabbage and a hollandaise sauce.
So once you've got over the initial shock and the terror, and you've got to choose a menu. I mean, how do you research something like that? Do you have to find out if she likes tin peas, or what do you do?
We did a few trials. They were then sent off to the palace for their feedback on it, and we come back with a dish that we've chosen for today.
And did they reject anything?
No, they were quite happy. We sent across, I think, four dishes, and that's the dish that they chose in the end. Sit the package, pick the best one out.
So when you did hers, how many did you do to pick the best one?
We probably had four out of
four,
that to get the right one.
Yeah.
Obviously, we had the Duke as well, so he had another couple. Yeah. There was his Queen, the Duke, and the rest of the table.
So the Duke must always get the second best one. Well, sometimes the third.
I should imagine so.
Yeah. That looks fantastic. I'm looking forward to it. A bit of everything together. really good.
Good.
It's really, really good. And did you finish it all up?
Yeah, the majority of it, we were told. So as soon as she finished, the rest of the room had to put their plates down as well.
Is that right? Everyone else has to stop eating when she stops?
Hmm.
Wow. I don't think I'd do that. I'm certainly not stopping now, anyway. That really is fantastic. Did she leave a tip?
No.
My journey is nearly at an end, but I have one last vital engagement on my royal tour, and it's the most important one of the lot, an appointment with the Queen herself. As part of her Jubilee tour, she's coming to RAF Cosford in Shropshire, where a crowd of around 35,000 people is gathering to greet her, and I'm joining them.
Throughout this programme, we've been meeting people who've had one-off brushes with the Queen, unique experiences that they'll never forget. But for most of the great British public, this is the closest they're going to get. Standing in a crowd, waving one of these.
Ahead of the Queen's arrival, excitement is building.
Well, what do you hope to get out of today?
Well, hopefully for my two little boys to see the Queen. They've bought her 12 pink roses, and hopefully they'll be able to give them to her today.
Well, it's the first time we've ever seen the Queen, and I think this as well. That's why we've come down today, really, to see the event.
Yeah. Celebrating the Jubilee.
Such a special occasion, and you wanted to see the Queen as well, didn't you?
What would you take? Would you take a wave? Would you take a smile?
Anything.
Anything.
Just being here.
Many of the people we've met during making this programme have said how they feel the Queen has a special connection with ordinary people. And that's what all these people are hoping for. A glimpse from the Queen, a wave, or most fantastic of all, a chance to meet her.
She's expected to arrive any second, and soon the royal helicopter is spotted on the horizon.
Well, after a few false starts, I think the helicopter's finally here, early, apparently. So people are very excited by this. Can you actually see her? You know, you can't trust the fact that she's here at all.
But if there were any lingering doubts, the sight of the royal cavalcade swiftly puts them to rest.
It's getting there. It's getting there.
I've been given a privileged spot with the press so I can get a closer look. Even so, on the first pass, I barely get a glimpse. But after a quick look around the museum here, the Queen emerges on foot, and I have a real chance to soak up the atmosphere. And it's magical.
It's funny because I didn't think that I'd be at all excited. I was worried it's going to be a damp squib, but I find myself clapping as she went past, which I don't know where that came from. And to see someone that you've seen so many times in the flesh, it is strange.
And it's not just me she's made an impression on.
She was fabulous, absolutely fabulous. She spent a lot of time talking to Chloe.
Yeah.
And she was just radiant, absolutely radiant.
Yeah.
Just an amazing person. And we were all very, very thrilled indeed to see her.
The royal visit is over, but it's put a smile on thousands of faces. It's clear to me that the people here and the people I've met see the Queen as part of their DNA. Someone who shared in our story, just as we've all followed hers.